This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Distracted Preacher. Author: Thomas Hardy. Chapter 1: How His Cold Was Cured. Something delayed the arrival of the Wesleyan minister, and a young man came temporarily in his stead. It was on the 13th of January 183 that Mr. Stockdale, the young man in question, made his humble entry into the village, unknown and almost unseen. But when those of the inhabitants, who styled themselves of his connection, became acquainted with him, they were rather pleased with the substitute than otherwise, though he had scarcely as yet acquired ballast of character sufficient to steady the consciences of the 140 Methodists of pure blood who, at this time, lived in Nether Moynton, and to give in addition supplementary support to the mixed race, which went to church in the morning and chapel in the evening, or when there was a tea, as many as 110 people more, all told, and including the parish clerk in the winter time, when it was too dark for the vicar to observe who passed up the street at 7 o'clock, which, to be just to him, he was never anxious to do. It was owing to this overlapping of creeds that the celebrated population puzzle arose among the denser gentry of the district around Nether Moynton. How could it be that a parish containing 50 of strong full-grown Episcopalians and nearly 30 of well-matured dissenters numbered barely 20 adults in all? The young man being personally interesting, those with whom he came in contact were content to waive for a while the graver question of his sufficiency. It is said that at this time of his life his eyes were affectionate, though without a ray of levity, that his hair was curly and his figure tall, that he was, in short, a very lovable youth, who won upon his female hearers as soon as they saw and heard him, and caused them to say, "Why didn't we know of this before he came, that we might have gied him a warmer welcome?" The fact was that, knowing him to be only provisionally selected, and expecting nothing remarkable in his person or doctrine, they and the rest of his flock in Nether Moynton had felt almost as indifferent about his advent as if they had been the soundest church-going parishioners in the country, and he their true and appointed parson. Thus when Stockdale set foot in the place, nobody had secured a lodging for him, and though his journey had given him a bad cold in the head, he was forced to attend to that business himself. On inquiry, he learnt that the only possible accommodation in the village would be found at the house of one Mrs. Lizzie Newberry, at the upper end of the street. It was a youth who gave this information, and Stockdale asked him who Mrs. Newberry might be. The boy said that she was a widow woman, who had got no husband because he was dead. Mr. Newberry, he added, had been a well-to-do man enough, as the saying was, and a farmer, but he had gone off in a decline. As regarded Mrs. Newberry's serious side, Stockdale gathered that she was one of the trimmers who went to church and chapel both. "I'll go there," said Stockdale, feeling that in the absence of purely sectarian lodgings, he could do no better. "She's a little particular, and won't hay government folks or curates or the pond's friends or such like," said the lad dubiously. "Ah, that may be a promising sign. I'll call." "Or no, just you go up and ask first if she can find room for me. I have to see one or two persons on another matter. You will find me down at the carrier's." In a quarter of an hour the lad came back, and said that Mrs. Newberry would have no objection to accommodate him, whereupon Stockdale called at the house. It stood within a garden hedge, and seemed to be roomy and comfortable. He saw an elderly woman, with whom he made arrangements to come the same night, since there was no inn in the place, and he wished to house himself as soon as possible, the village being a local center from which he was to radiate at once to the different small chapels in the neighborhood. He forthwith sent his luggage to Mrs. Newberry's from the carrier's, where he had taken shelter, and in the evening walked up to his temporary home. As he now lived there, Stockdale felt it unnecessary to knock at the door, and entering quietly, he had the pleasure of hearing footsteps scudding away like mice into the back quarters. He advanced to the parlor, as the front room was called, though its stone floor was scarcely disguised by the carpet, which only overlaid the trodden areas, leaving sandy deserts under the bulging moldings of the table legs, playing with brass furniture. But the room looked snug and cheerful. The firelight shone out brightly, trembling on the knobs and handles, and lurking in great strength on the undersurface of the chimneypiece. A deep armchair, covered with horsehair and studded with a countless throng of brass nails, was pulled up on one side of the fireplace. The tea things were on the table, the teapot cover was open, and a little handbell had been laid at that precise point towards which a person seated in the great chair might be expected instinctively to stretch his hand. Stockdale sat down, not objecting to his experience of the room thus far, and began his residence by tinkling the bell. A little girl crept in at the summons and made tea for him. Her name, she said, was Martha Sarer, and she lived out there, nodding towards the road and village generally. Before Stockdale had got far with his meal, a tap sounded on the door behind him, and on his telling the inquirer to come in, a rustle of garments caused him to turn his head. He saw before him a fine and extremely well-made young woman, with dark hair, a wide, sensible, beautiful forehead, eyes that warmed him before he knew it, and a mouth that was in itself a picture to all appreciative souls. "Can I get you anything else for tea?" she said, coming forward a step or two, an expression of liveliness on her features, and her hand waving the door by its edge. "Nothing, thank you," said Stockdale, thinking less of what he replied than of what might be her relation to the household. "You are quite sure," said the young woman, apparently aware that he had not considered his answer. He conscientiously examined the tea things, and found them all there. "Quite sure, Miss Newberry," he said. "It is Mrs. Newberry," she said. "Lizzie Newberry, I used to be Lizzie Simpkins." "Oh, I beg your pardon, Mrs. Newberry." And before he had occasion to say more, she left the room. Stockdale remained in some doubt till Martha Sarah came to clear the table. "Whose house is this, my little woman?" said he.
"Mrs. Lizzie Newberry's, sir."
"Then Mrs. Newberry is not the old lady I saw this afternoon."
"No.
That's Mrs. Newberry's mother. It was Mrs. Newberry who commented into you just by now, because she wanted to see if you was good-looking." Later in the evening, when Stockdale was about to begin supper, she came again. "I have come myself, Mr. Stockdale," she said. The minister stood up in acknowledgement of the honor. "I am afraid little Martha might not make you understand. What will you have for supper? There's cold rabbit and there's a ham uncut." Stockdale said he could get on nicely with those viands, and supper was laid. He had no more than cut a slice, when tap-tap came to the door again. The minister had already learnt that this particular rhythm in taps denoted the fingers of his enkindling landlady, and the doomed young fellow buried his first mouthful under a look of receptive blandness. "We have a chicken in the house, Mr. Stockdale. I quite forgot to mention it just now. Perhaps you would like Martha Sarer to bring it up." Stockdale had advanced far enough in the art of being a young man to say that he did not want the chicken, unless she brought it up herself, but when it was uttered, he blushed at the daring gallantry of the speech, perhaps a shade too strong for a serious man and a minister. In 3 minutes the chicken appeared, but to his great surprise, only in the hands of Martha Sarah. Stockdale was disappointed, which perhaps it was intended that he should be. He had finished supper, and was not in the least anticipating Mrs. Newberry again that night, when she tapped and entered as before. Stockdale's gratified look told that she had lost nothing by not appearing when expected. It happened that the cold in the head from which the young man suffered had increased with the approach of night, and before she had spoken he was seized with a violent fit of sneezing which he could not anyhow repress. Mrs. Newberry looked full of pity. "Your cold is very bad tonight, Mr. Stockdale." Stockdale replied that it was rather troublesome. "And I've a good mind," she added archly, looking at the cheerless glass of water on the table, which the abstemious minister was going to drink.
"Yes, Mrs. Newberry."
"I've a good mind that you should have something more likely to cure it than that cold stuff." "Well," said Stockdale, looking down at the glass, "as there is no inn here and nothing better to be got in the village, of course it will do." To this she replied, "There is something better, not far off, though not in the house. I really think you must try it, or you may be ill." "Yes, Mr. Stockdale, you shall." She held up her finger, seeing that he was about to speak. "Don't ask what it is, wait and you shall see." Lizzie went away, and Stockdale waited in a pleasant mood. Presently she returned with her bonnet and cloak on, saying, "I am so sorry, but you must help me to get it. Mother has gone to bed. Will you wrap yourself up and come this way, and please bring that cup with you?" Stockdale, a lonely young fellow who had for weeks felt a great craving for somebody on whom to throw away superfluous interest, and even tenderness, was not sorry to join her, and followed his guide through the back door, across the garden, to the bottom where the boundary was a wall. This wall was low, and beyond it Stockdale discerned in the nightshades several gray headstones and the outlines of the church roof and tower. "It is easy to get up this way," she said, stepping upon a bank which abutted on the wall, then putting her foot on the top of the stonework and descending a spring inside, where the ground was much higher, as is the manner of graveyards to be. Stockdale did the same, and followed her in the dusk across the irregular ground till they came to the tower door, which, when they had entered, she softly closed behind them. "You can keep a secret," she said in a musical voice. "Like an iron chest," said he fervently. Then from under her cloak she produced a small lighted lantern, which the minister had not noticed that she carried at all. The light showed them to be close to the singing gallery stairs, under which lay a heap of lumber of all sorts, but consisting mostly of decayed framework, pews, panels, and pieces of flooring that from time to time had been removed from their original fixings in the body of the edifice and replaced by new. "Perhaps you will drag some of those boards aside," she said, holding the lantern over her head to light him better. "Or will you take the lantern while I move them?" "I can manage it," said the young man, and acting as she ordered, he uncovered, to his surprise, a row of little barrels bound with wood hoops, each barrel being about as large as the nave of a heavy wagon wheel. When they were laid open, Lizzie fixed her eyes on him, as if she wondered what he would say. "You know what they are?" she asked, finding that he did not speak. "Yes, barrels," said Stockdale simply. He was an inland man, the son of highly respectable parents, and brought up with a single eye to the ministry, and the sight suggested nothing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.